What's up, everybody? Welcome once again to Tale of the Tape, brought to you by Gym Bag Entertainment, and it's the show about combat sports by guys that love combat sports. And as always, it's your host, Craig, here with my co-host.
Your neck-cranking newscaster, Michael Johnson.
Awesome. And we are back with actual fights to talk about.
Yes.
You know?
Action-packed.
Yeah, we're action-packed here. We got not only a fight to tell you about, but we got a fight coming up. One of the dopest pay-per-views we've seen in a long time. And I was obviously on the wrong page.
Before we dive into the UFC, hats off to Anthony Joshua getting his belts back from Andy Ruiz.
Yes, that was big.
Unanimous decision.
Mm-hmm.
He looked good. He was safe.
Of course.
Stayed safe, you know, slipped the jab, crisp, showed that he was the better boxer, you know, and that, you know, Andy Ruiz is probably the better puncher, you know.
Oh, of course. They said that he didn't want to get into a rumble.
Yeah.
Where Ruiz is the better, faster striker.
Faster hands, you know, too heavy of a puncher to stay inside and go with him. That was the problem last time, you know.
What's weird, though, is when you were talking about, you said they both had trimmed a lot of weight.
But when I had been watching videos of Ruiz early in his camp, he had trimmed like 30 pounds to start his camp. And then something happened and he put on more.
Yeah. Like,
and not more muscle.
Just like, more fat.
He just was fatter.
Yeah, he said that the extra weight threw him, like, affected him.
I don't know if that was his plan, to just be heavier. I don't know.
I don't know.
If something happened in his camp, you know, like he got a little lackluster. I don't know what happened.
But I think that no matter what, like, I understand that Joshua fights the winner of
Deontay Wilder trying to work it out. You know, Deontay Wilder's always saying that people are ducking and stuff like that, but there was a contract that you know, a story I was reading with solid facts on it.
Yeah.
That you know, years ago when Klitschko was a heavyweight champion, they had sent a proposal to Deontay Wilder and he didn't want it, and Anthony Joshua took it. And that's how Anthony Joshua became the champion.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Interesting. Well, I know that Anthony Joshua faces the winner of Deontay Wilder and Tyson Fury, but I think no matter what happens, whether you know, whoever he fights, I think he still has to go back and give Ruiz a third.
They got to get a rubber match, you know, and they talked about it at the end too, about you know, that they got to run it back. So, yeah, we'll probably be seeing that again.
And I want to see that one.
Andy Ruiz got to figure out what he did wrong. Mm-hmm. You know, he hasn't had a lot of high-caliber fights in his career, you know. Gets the title, doesn't know what to do, you know.
It is what it is. Hey, anybody can win on any night. I saw a clip of a bare-knuckle fight where a dude got clipped in the face, and he didn't get knocked out.
But he went down in
so much pain.
It just skims the front of his nose pretty much, like just right in. Yeah, it was like a hook, and I think it's like a Mike Perry type of situation with the, you know, nose on the side of the face.
That's a rough one.
And hats off to Lynn's own Ronald Ellis, Akeem Ellis. You know, from the Ellis boxing family of Lynn. And he got another win on Showtime this past weekend.
Really?
And, hats off to him.
Dope.
Keep moving up.
We talked about it on the End Zone, but I just want to give one more shout out to the Lynn cheerleading squad. The Rams won
national
championship. They went down to like Disneyland or Disney World or whatever. Yeah. Came in first place. Girls I know personally, Cassie and Brittany are the coaches. So that was pretty awesome for them. Congratulations
once
again. Yeah.
Good job.
So what else we got? Anything?
That's it for local and, you know, boxing headlines. So,
all right, let's jump into it. UFC Fight Night, UFC on ESPN 7. Overeem versus Rosenstrike, Saturday, December 7th at 9 p.m. at the Capital One Arena in Washington, D.C. This one was pretty good. You know, not a lot of disappointment in this particular one. Let's start it right off. You know, that's the one thing that's funny about UFCs on ESPN. ESPN, unlike Fight Nights, is they do come with an early prelim.
They do.
I didn't realize that.
It's weird.
It is weird. I thought it was only a pay-per-view thing, but nope. If it's an ESPN, then it gets an early prelim.
Yeah.
And it started off with a pretty good one. Mahmoud Muradov, 23-6, going up against the 15-9 Trevor Smith.
Poor Trevor Smith. Mahmoud was on point. The movement, slinging the jab, working off the jab, it was incredible. You know, a couple of right hands here and there, just content to box him. Yeah. And Trevor Smith couldn't do a thing about it.
Couldn't do nothing, couldn't stop it, couldn't get inside.
A little bit of a low kick first round by Trevor Smith, no big deal. Mahmoud shakes it off, they get back to it. You know, Trevor Smith couldn't get inside that jab. Mahmoud catches a kick for a takedown, almost gets a rear naked choke right at the end of round two.
Yeah, but saved
by
the bell.
Instantly, almost gets the rear naked choke. Frustrated Trevor Smith so bad. You know, he just let him dance. He just didn't do anything. He gets a quick takedown, I believe it was in round two, for Trevor Smith. Gets nothing out of it. Mahmoud gets up. And then in the third round, he repeatedly hurts him to the body.
Oh, man.
Body shots. And then starts
brutal.
Putting it to the face. And the combo was awesome. He throws the right to the body.
Yes.
Lands it hard.
Flush.
You know, throws the left hook upstairs, and Trevor Smith blocks it, but doesn't see the right hook coming right after it. Sends the mouthpiece into the corner on the other side of the cage.
It's never a good thing. I feel like that's like the moment you get posterized is when your mouthpiece gets knocked out of your mouth.
And face down, you know, completely out 4 minutes into the round three. And that's a big time highlight.
Yeah, it is. that's a big victory for Mahmoud.
Absolutely.
And you know,
great way to start the show.
Yeah, great way to start the show. Get it going with a literal bang. In the women's strawweight division, Verna Jandiroba, 14-1, going up against the 6-2 Mallory Martin. And this seemed like a one-sided fight as well.
It pretty much was. You know, Vina, as they called her.
Oh, it's Vina?
I thought it was Verna, but they kept calling her Vina, the commentating team on the UFC. So,
okay.
You know,
they make sure to get it right.
I trust in them.
Yep.
You know, she comes out right off the bat with a great double leg. Vina, you know, passes the guard. Mallory immediately, you know, trying some decent guillotine attempts. But over tries the guillotine attempt. Once she had her guard passed, like Vina was smart to pass her guard while she was holding her neck.
Correct.
And, you know, the guillotine was no longer there, but it left Mallory left herself in the arm triangle. Vina starts cranking it. Mallory with an incredible walking across on the fence to flip herself over and get
like,
out
but
of that.
At first it was cool because, like, you know, when you see someone get put in a triangle, you're just like, that's done.
Yeah.
It's such a tight position. But like at first she was just laying her legs over.
And it reminded me so much, you know, if you get put in a guillotine from a full guard, you know, the first defense is to tripod your body up and the rest of your weight on the top of your head.
Okay.
And that gives you more space to move side to side to free your neck. So it almost seemed like the same thing to me.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, what a smart thing
smart
to do.
Smart move. And then, yeah, like you said, ends up finding a way to flip herself over.
And, you know, just the striking lackluster from both of them.
Kinda. Yeah, very lackluster.
I thought Mallory might get a punch on her, but nothing really. Second round, more of the same. Vina with another double leg. Takes her back in the scramble, like, instantly. A little bit of hand fighting from Mallory, but then, you know, rear naked choke from Vina.
Her specialty.
Round two, minute and 16 seconds in.
Yeah, it's a very good fight for Vina.
Absolutely.
She definitely showcased her ground game. But if you want to win in this division, you got to work on them hands.
You got to be able to throw some hands.
There's a lot of girls in the strawweight division with a ground game and with tough ground game.
Absolutely.
So you can't rely on that alone. That's something she definitely needs to work on, but a lot of good things coming from the bug-eyed girl.
Yes. Very intense with her
eyes. Very intense with her eyes, yo. So that was cool. All right. That ends the early prelims. Now we jump into the prelims, starting off with Joe Selecki, 8-2. Going up against the 16-8 Matt Wyman.
You know, this was a case of the old man versus the young guy.
Touché.
You know, the up-and-comer versus the experienced fighter who's past his prime.
Yeah, way past.
The only reason that Matt Wyman wasn't finished is because of how much experience he has, you know. And maybe Selecki, you know, give him another year or two to put his ground and pound together a little better and get a little better at, you know, fighting the hands for some submissions. He would have choked him. How many times did he take his back? I mean, Selecki with takedowns over and over, top control. Ground and pound, just iffy, not good enough, like I said. You know, couldn't put him away. His submission attempts, little lackluster. He needs to explode a little better. You know, a little trash talk between them. Did you notice?
Oh, yeah, on the ground.
Yeah.
And not just a little. I mean, Matt Wyman was, it sounded like he was going.
He was upset.
Yeah, because Selecki had his back. He flips it right at the end and then just starts, knows he can't do anything, so just starts screaming in his face.
And
what are you going to do? And he said, end your career.
Yeah, and he said, put you out of a job.
Yeah, put you out of a job.
And Selecki was like, I'm sorry, you know. That was the New Jersey coming out of me. Yeah. Ain't nothing wrong with saying that, man.
Yeah,
He said
he's a good Christian, and that, you know, but if you're going to talk trash, I'm from Jersey, so you can get it too.
Absolutely.
And I like that, you know, if you're going to talk trash, he's going to talk trash back, but that's not his way.
It was frustration from Wyman. I mean, Selecki just grinded him out.
Yeah.
Like, it was a picture perfect grind you out type
of win. And you know what, though? What I like about Selecki is it wasn't like a lay and pray.
No, it wasn't.
You know, he was putting in work. He was making attempts. He just couldn't get anything to finish.
He couldn't finish it. And like I said, a lot of that's got to go to Wyman's experience. He's been around for so long. Mm-hmm. He's been in every position with experienced fighters. So, you know, but hats off to Selecki moving up. For sure.
Absolutely. All right. In the featherweight division, Bryce Mitchell, 11-0, going up against the 8-2, Matt Sales.
Great fight. Great round of
fighting. Great round of fighting.
Yeah.
Great finish.
Yeah. Bryce Mitchell, really confident with his boxing.
Yeah.
He's actually gone on in the post-fight in an interview that I seen to say that if he fought Floyd Mayweather, that he would kill him.
Wow.
And I said, okay, Bryce.
Wow.
Take a breath. Anyways.
Wow.
Great hands, for sure. But what we really seen in this was his grappling.
Yeah.
Great takedown against Sales. The grappling was fast with these guys. You know, the featherweights, they can move. And, they were still so early that they were dry. And I think that's what really helped him sync it up. He was going to take his back. Ends up, can't get the second hook over the other hip, so he decides to just hold his leg. And then out of nowhere, you see it in Mitchell's face, like, I got an opportunity to lock up a twister if I just get his arm behind my head.
Is this it?
And just completely goes for it, pours everything into it, wraps the arm behind his head, has the opposite leg behind his back, locked in between his legs, grabs around the head, twists his whole body, definitely gets technique of the week.
Mm.
Only the second twister to ever be pulled off in UFC history. And
that's it. Like, super crazy. I just remember that was the I came over Denny's house and we're watching. I only got to watch that one fight.
Crazy.
And I'm like, yo, dude, just get him with like a neck crank, and then we realize it's actually a twister. Yeah. And it's like, wow, yo, like that. To one. Impressive to get a twister.
Right.
Two, embarrassing to
it
be
is.
Beat by a twister.
It is, because as soon as, you feel both legs wrap around your one leg, you should know immediately, you're being set up, you have to move.
Yeah.
It's not like, it's like the Peruvian necktie, like we said, or you know, some of these other moves that you just don't see.
You just don't see them.
They're gym moves, you know. You don't see them in the octagon. And
what's the other one when you have, when someone refuses to give up on the guillotine?
It's the what's his name? Choke. Aubin St. Preux.
Yeah, the Aubin St. Preux choke. Yeah, what is it? It's the Darce.
Von Flew
the Von Flew choke.
But we call it the Von Preux choke.
The Von Preux choke. Yeah, so like certain submissions that, like, you know, are easily preventable.
Yeah.
But people allow themselves to get caught.
But it's because you overcommitted on one thing or another.
Yeah.
And he just let him stay on his one leg like that, and that set him right up.
Gotta say though, Bryce Mitchell officially on my list of fighters I hate.
Oh yeah? Why is that?
Did you not watch the interview in the ring?
I don't know if I seen his in-ring octagon.
He's another Kobe Covington.
Is he? Yeah.
Donald Trump, you have give me a call. You need any of these congressmen beat down, I'm your man. And I'm like, seriously, bro?
Yeah, he can love Trump if he wants. I don't care. You know, that's his.
He's a Kobe Covington.
Keep your affiliation out of the octagon.
Yeah, exactly.
Nobody cares.
And you can handle Floyd Mayweather. Come on, bro.
That's pretty stupid.
You know what though? He's
a good boxer though.
He is a good boxer. You know, I would like to. There's only one person. I know he's not going to come down to featherweight anymore. But I'd like to see him face Conor. Mm. I think Conor's got like that excellent striking.
You can fight Floyd? Fight me.
And Conor fought Floyd. You know, and it was a good fight. All right, another featherweight fight. The apocalypse battle. Billy Quarantillo, 12-2, going up against the 8-2 Jacob Kilburn.
I thought Trevor Smith had a bad night.
Oof.
Jacob Kilburn was in survival mode from the first second to the last second.
Yeah.
You know, the look on his face the entire time, like, I felt bad for the poor man. Like, all he did was survive.
Yeah.
Until he was finished. Quarantillo just put a beating on him. Jacob Kilburn landed 6 significant strikes.
Really? Wow.
Billy Quarantillo landed 74 out of 139 total landed. 74 significant strikes.
So he landed 139
strikes overall.
But 74 of them were significant.
Yes.
Wow.
Compared to six. And the reason why is all the top control.
Yeah, of course.
So they're not exchanging. It's just him holding him down and pounding on him. Over and over. 5 submission attempts. To Kilburn's, you know, credit, he escaped 4 of them.
Yeah.
You know.
Wow.
The takedowns were just easy. Kilburn had nothing for Billy Quarantillo. I mean, yeah, all I wrote on his side was survival mode every second, because that's all it was. Round 2, 3 minutes, 18 seconds in, Quarantillo's looking for the armbar from the back. And let Kilburn spin himself around so that he could just lock up the triangle instead, and submits him easily.
Easily.
Dominant fight.
Yeah, this was just an absolute domination.
I haven't seen this dominant since, what was it, Mike Davis in that... that poor kid who got his face bashed in.
Oh, man.
Thomas Gifford.
Yeah, I thought you was going to say Yair Rodriguez versus Frankie Edgar, because that was just brutal. He beat the bag out of him. Right up to this moment, your boy was perfect. I think you might have been too, but I know we were perfect up until this moment. You might have one more on me after this next one, but in the welterweight division,
I got a problem with not
writing who you chose.
Yeah, hold on.
Didn't you put check marks?
I end up stopping halfway for some reason. Like, look, I got 1, 2, 3, and then I stopped. I definitely said Quarantillo.
Yep.
So I'm 100% so far.
All right. So in the welterweight division,
here's where I
Thiago Alves, 23-14, going up against the 28-11-1-1 no contest, getting every record. Tim Means.
Stat sheet stuffer, Tim Means.
Yes, the stat sheet stuffer, Tim Means. That's awesome.
You know, I wanted this to be good for Thiago.
Me too.
And when it started, it looked good.
It did. Look good all around.
Big shots from Alves early. You know, landing punches, landing good leg kicks, like, you know, we always see. That would have been a problem for sure. But Tim Means just out of you know, he was even clinching early to avoid the pressure from Alves.
I mean, Alves left a footprint
was putting it on him with one kick, too.
Yeah.
Like, and, you know, they separate after the clinch, and Means lands a straight left that just puts him down.
That
rocks his whole night.
That was an exceptionally clean, like,
and it was
straight
quick,
jab. Yeah,
quick counter. He goes down, survives well, covers up, you know, rolls back, goes to try to stand up, but gives up his neck. Tim, you know, grabs the crunch guillotine, you know.
Yeah.
That's real hard to get out of the standing one. Especially, I think it's worse when guys are sitting against the fence. Like
yeah,
the way
you stand because you're
lifting.
Thiago was lifting him up.
And he just, yeah, you like put your body weight on him and pull. Like, yeah, it's pretty devastating.
Yeah, that was, I mean, because you saw it, because not only did he grimace hard,
right,
but he instantly tapped for it.
Because I think with that, it's not even so much I'm going to pass out. It's like, I think my neck's going to break off.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, because, I mean, he's lifting your body weight up off the ground by your throat and neck. So that's a pretty brutal submission.
You know, round one submission for Tim Means at 2 minutes and 38 seconds.
Did you pick Alves for this fight?
I did.
All right, so we're both on the same on the same fence. Because in this one, I picked exceptionally well. I think I only got three
wrong. You did your left side of the page.
Yeah, left side of the page. All right, that was the main event of the prelims. Entering into the main event, starting off with another awesome fight. Rob Font, 16-4, going up against the 15-2 Ricky Simon.
This was a good one. You know, high-paced action, great wrestling from Ricky Simon. He had 6 out of 16 takedowns. He attempted 16 takedowns
attempts.
I mean, he got six. That's 37%. But I mean, six takedowns is significant.
It is significant.
You know, he lands 65 out of 161 total strikes. But out of those, he you know, lands 59 significant. So all of his punches pretty powerful, you know. Rob Font with 212 total strikes.
Wow.
And he's got 90 significant. So, I mean,
almost half.
He's almost half, 50% on power punches. Ricky Simon definitely just a stronger puncher in general. But the output by Rob Font was great. Had a takedown there in the second round, I believe, Rob Font. And just that great jab working for him. This was a unanimous decision for Rob Font, and I was, you know,
surprised by that one?
A little bit. I thought it might have been a split, because with the takedowns, it's just that, you know, Ricky couldn't get nothing going from the takedowns.
And I think that's got to be a factor. Like, just because you can take someone down, if you can't keep them down and you can't make nothing happen, what good is a takedown?
When you're putting a guy down and he's standing up instantly, you know, then you end up getting six takedowns. It looks like a huge amount, but he just kept standing up. He's got no ground and pound on him, no top control. So, Rob Font, unanimous decision with the, you know, almost double the striking output.
Good job, Rob Font, representing Massachusetts, baby.
And I said Worcester, but he's from Woburn. My apologies.
Oh, Woburn. Oh, a little closer.
Yeah.
Help me out, because even though I looked at the name, I forgot to write down the actual name of this fight.
Yeah, because the UFC fooled us.
Yes.
They
put Freitas in.
They had, Charles Freitas or whatever.
Geraldo
de Freitas Jr.
Yeah.
But, and they had said he was the fill-in. But Cody Stamann was the fill-in.
So Cody Stamann, record unknown, going up against the 14-3 2-0 contest, Song Yadong.
Cody Stamann ranked number 9 in the bantamweight division.
Wow.
This is the fight that I said, you know, I said he replaced Stamann, which I thought he did. However, Stamann was there. Because we saw it.
Because we saw him fight.
Yes. And we saw him get robbed, frankly, I think.
100% robbed.
Yes.
I don't know if I wouldn't have said it would have been a split decision, but he definitely got robbed.
Yeah, let's take it to the numbers to make it clear how much he was robbed. Song Yadong, again, I think they, you know, a little bit like Ricky Simone, you know, much more of a powerful puncher than Cody Stamann. However, when, you know, you only landed 30 significant strikes, you know, he threw 127 total.
Wow.
Lands 49 strikes total, Song Yadong. Lands 30 significant strikes. Okay.
So 75% of the landed strikes were significant, but you only landed about 30% of the strikes you threw.
Right.
Wow.
Cody Stamann lands 117 out of 150.
Wow. So way more accurate.
Right.
Like 80% accuracy.
And lands 41 significant strikes.
Okay.
Again, but he doesn't strike as powerful. But
he lands the same amount of significant.
Almost the same amount of significant strikes as Song Yadong.
Wow.
But doubling the output, you know, overall landed strikes. More than double. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, more than double.
So.
Yes.
Then we factor in Cody Stamann's 5 takedowns. Not only 5 takedowns, but he had 6 minutes of top control throughout that 3-round fight.
Wow. So just over a round of top control. Wow.
I don't know how this could be ruled a draw, but that is what happened here.
This is interesting.
A majority draw.
Yeah, it was a majority draw.
So it's leaning towards Cody, but then the other two are...
Yeah, because the first guy gave it to him, right. And then the other two guys gave an exact... Oh, but there was also... this is the other thing that bothers me, is how is it a majority draw, even though Song Yadong lands an illegal knee to the head?
Right.
So you took a point away from him, which means he won.
I totally forgot.
Yes, which means Song Yadong won 2 rounds by the judges' scorecards.
Right.
I just remembered that. So he got a point taken away. Yep, point taken away.
And still ends up with a draw. I don't understand. Cody Stamann needs to take this to the commission
absolutely.
And get this overturned.
I mean, numbers alone show you that. Numbers alone and a minus point.
The numbers are crazy. You know, plus the point taken away from Yadong. And Yadong being the counterpuncher, Stamann was in his face coming forward the whole time. So I probably would have gave him aggression even. I don't understand. I'm bewildered by this.
I hate draws, and I feel like we're getting more draws nowadays. Like, we haven't seen as many draws as we've seen in the last, like, 3 months than we've seen in UFC almost the entire time I've been watching, at least.
Right.
Like, I feel like it's almost non-existent, but...
And I hate majority draws.
Oh, majority draws are
like
dumb.
One ref said that he won. Why doesn't he win?
And that's a valid point. Like, if you got 2 draws and then a ref says he wins, it should just be
if
that point.
If you got 2 refs
point,
that,
yeah.
like, I can't... Two judges, like, I can't decide. And one's like, well, no, I say he wins. Okay, why don't he win?
There you go.
I don't know.
It's stupid. All right. And then in the women's bantamweight division, Aspen Ladd, 8-1, going up against the 12-4, 1-0 contest, Jan Kuznetskaya.
Jana Kuznetskaya.
I'm trying to say it all fast.
Yeah. Aspen Ladd, very happy to see this fight. You know, she... The striking was pretty even throughout.
Yeah.
And I thought that was great because Kuznetskaya had great length, great movement. Her jab was good.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was just, she was nice and long, had the good kicks, but Aspen Ladd was well composed. She has that, what seems to be a flat-footed style.
Yes.
But she is on the balls of her feet bouncing forward, but... You know, she just doesn't have much knee bend and much hip bend, you know?
Oh, okay, yeah. But she, like I said before, she has the striking.
She's finding the range. Her hands are heavy. You know, she had good pressure. Kept getting in Kuznetskaya's face the whole time.
Kuznetskaya had somewhat of a strength advantage, too, in the grappling exchange.
I was very surprised by the clinch of Kunitskaya. Mm-hmm. You know, how she could press Aspen against the fence like she did. Aspen, I thought, would have rode her out on top. You know what I mean? I thought this would have looked like, you know, what's it called? Selecki and Matt Wyman a little bit, you know? But Kunitskaya, impressive with the grappling and the overall strength. I think that's what it was more than anything.
Yeah, definitely overall strength.
You know, Aspen couldn't really get inside as much because Kunitskaya was so light on her feet, striking, had good takedown defense.
But until she does get taken down.
But, yeah.
Can we talk about the craziness?
Of what?
Did you not see the Aspen Ladd fight?
Oh, yeah, right. Of course I did.
So she takes her down. She gets the top control going for the ground and pound. Oh, and yeah. It's just like, Yo, like, I ain't never, like, she was hitting her like she was, like, she was screaming like she was mad at her.
Yeah, that's an Aspen Ladd thing. Hasn't done it as much as that in previous fights. But, yeah.
That was crazy.
Was really going for it there. And was that the end of round one?
I think that was the end of round one.
That was the end of round one because round two was pretty much striking and clinching against the cage.
Correct.
But, yeah, really tried to put that ground and pound together. You know, couldn't finish her. Second round, like I said, a bunch of, you know, striking and clinching against the cage. The corner men in between second and third round, you know, he's looking Aspen in the face, starts swearing and hyping her up. Like,
oh, you know, I heard them say that, but I didn't see it.
In her face and don't move. Punch her in the face and keep punching. Like, he was just getting in her face. Yeah, bunch of, you know, expletives in there that they were bleeping out on ESPN.
Oh, and, man.
She said post-fight that it really did light a fire
under. Yeah, I saw that part where she said it's what she needed to hear.
Round three comes out, the bell rings, she comes straight out, feints with the right hand, and throws the biggest left hook as Kunitskaya is circling to that side.
Oh. Boom.
Clips her on the jaw, drops her, you know, swarms her. Yells some more while she throws some more left hands.
Yeah, and, man, that was...
Gets herself a nice TKO.
That was a beautiful... not only a beautiful right hook, but a good solid win for Aspen Ladd. Oh, she definitely needed this after that hard loss.
And a smart strike, too. I mean, you know, when you faint on somebody to get him to move a certain direction and then meet him there with the punch, that's masterful striking. Mm-hmm. That's smart, you know. And she had been coming in with that lead straight right and all fight, and every time, you know, Yana would circle to the right. So Aspen feints it, throws a big left hook,
boom,
lands it perfectly. Classic boxing.
And for a girl who's a wrestler, you expect submissions, and then you get a nice little TKO.
Round three.
Beautiful.
33 seconds in.
Nice.
Yeah, well done.
All right. In the heavyweight division, a lot of drama. Stefan Struve, 29-11, going up against the 36-12, Ben Rothwell. I got robbed here of my choice.
Yeah.
Definitely thought this was going to be a Stefan Struve fight.
Me too. He was a little too calm, honestly. He was letting Ben in close a little bit. He was doing all right, but, you know, we got to talk about the two low blows
from
Ben Rothwell. Clear, you know, brutal ball shots.
Oh,
you know?
I feel like he was saying that they went into his stomach.
Yeah. The pain was in his stomach
anybody in that much pain. We've seen some hard shots. Stefan Struve had took a shot that had him looking like it was the worst shot anybody could ever take.
I've never seen anybody flail around from a low blow like that. And I mean, not even a kickboxing match or anything. And I've seen a ton. Can you claim that he might have been selling it? But why? Why would you sell it? You know, like, it doesn't make sense.
See, because we have seen Stefan Struve get the bag beaten out of him and win.
He's
we talked about
that.
It last week. But, you know, sometimes toughness goes away, maybe?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Either way, Dan Margiliata definitely shouldn't be telling fighters who he thinks is ahead on scorecards.
Yeah, that was the second one. That was after the second one, though. That was terrible.
Because that is swaying somebody, you know, to possibly continue or something like that. That shouldn't be... He should not care one bit whether Struve continues.
Oh, yeah, he shouldn't be... I mean...
You gotta run that fight completely unbiased. Yeah. You cannot be telling a fighter, you're ahead on the scorecards. You should be ahead on the scorecards two rounds.
Yeah, and if it goes to the decision, you're definitely gonna win.
But if they call it now, it'll be a no contest.
Yeah.
Because it was before the end of the second round.
I feel like I almost understand his reasoning, and I think
maybe you're trying to look out for a fighter.
No.
But it's not your job.
I think what's happening is I think he's already been part of a stoppage fight, mm-hmm. no contest. There's been three in the last, 2 months, where
Dan was trying to keep it from happening at all.
Yeah, he didn't want the fight to go to a no contest.
He should not care about that. His mindset should be to call the clear winner and to protect both fighters as they fight, and that's it.
I agree with you. He should only be saying, do you need more time?
Right.
Are you ready? Right. You know, those type of things. He shouldn't be trying to persuade either way.
He should have been saying, you don't have to continue if you're injured. Protect the fighter. Mm-hmm. You know? Bad call by Murgliata. But Stefan Struve decides to continue after, you know, writhing in pain for a second time.
Had to take the whole 5 minutes both times.
Here's what really led to the finish, though. Did you notice the leg kick by Struve that Ben Rothwell checks right before the finish?
No.
It was a brutal check, and I think Struve might have injured his leg. If you see it, that's what got Ben within range to start landing them uppercuts inside.
I did not recognize that.
Yes, Stefan Struve throws a big leg kick. Ben Rothwell checked it perfectly, and you see the shin bounce off of the other shin, and Struve took the worst of it, and he hobbles back a half a step.
Okay, I did see that part of it.
And Rothwell closed the distance and was able to land the big uppercuts and put him out.
Yeah, he definitely put him away in great fashion. I feel bad. I always feel bad when you have a situation like that. You know that Stefan Struve did not enter that after that second kick. He was not ready to. He wasn't able to continue.
Completely compromised. I mean, even no matter how long you gave him, he wouldn't have been able to continue at 100%. You know, the only way to do that is to call that fight, no contest or not.
Yeah.
You know,
there's got to be some. I know that you can't, but like, there's got to be something more that can be done to a fighter who lands two groin shots in a fight.
I mean, you can disqualify him if you want. That's up to the ref.
Yeah.
You know?
Because, I mean,
but you can't disqualify without a point taken at least first.
Yeah. It's tough. I almost feel like a point should be taken first groin shot.
Yeah.
Because
That one looked the worst.
Yeah.
That one looked worse than the second one.
Because it was from the foot just came right in like a laser.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, boy, man. I feel bad for Stefan Struve, man. I hope he's had all the kids he was going to have
And Struve doesn't hold nothing against Rothwell or against Dan Murgliata for the advice either, you know?
He's being a professional and a gentleman. And I respect that.
He said it's his fault for continuing.
True.
You know,
I if I was him, I don't know if I'd want to continue. Like, you know, the guy who wants to be the man,
He knew he shouldn't have continued, but he got up to continue.
And that's because he's a true fighter.
Absolutely.
All right, in the co-main event, women's strawweight division, Mariana Rodriguez, 12-0, one draw, going up against the 8-1, Lenitha Calvillo.
Where do you get Lenitha? It's Cynthia.
Oh, yeah. I have a C, and it looks like an L.
Oh, that's okay. and we got Marina Rodriguez, not Mariana. It's okay. Interesting fight.
I like to mess up names.
Real, real interesting fight, because that's another robbery here.
Absolutely. Doesn't even make sense.
No. Marina Rodriguez, again, looked good. Kept the center of the octagon, probably. You know, perhaps more aggressive in the striking.
Yep.
But let's go to the numbers again. She throws 145 total strikes, lands 61, 56 significant for Marina Rodriguez.
So she's about 90% accurate. Well, 90% significant out of the strikes landed.
Calvillo, 173 overall. 112 landed, 78 significant.
Ooh, okay.
So she outstruck her.
Yep.
You know, by far. the power, more powerful of the strikes. Yeah, I mean, she's got her almost 2-1 on volume striking. And she had 3 out of 4 takedowns. The top control was great. The ground and pound was vicious. Cynthia Calvillo with a robbery here. I don't know what happened, but they called another draw here.
Yeah, it's makes no sense.
Yeah.
So,
and another majority draw.
Yeah, majority draw.
With one of them with a card for Calvillo. Yeah. And Marina Rodriguez is, you know, out in the media crying like she should have the win.
Oh, so she thought she won.
I'll give it to Song Yadong on their draw. He was not upset because he knew he lost that fight.
Well, I think he was upset because I think he knew he lost that fight.
Right, because, but he wasn't upset with the draw decision.
Oh, yeah, no, no. You know, you lose a fight,
Cody Stamann was baffled. You know, and
But Song Yadong showed the respect. He was like, nah, I lost that fight.
He knew he lost that fight, yeah. Absolutely. But, you know, Marina Rodriguez is delusional.
She wants to add to that win column and not anything else.
Right, I get that, you know.
She was given a gift.
Calvillo, she got to figure out if she's going to be able to make weight, though. And if you can't fight at flyweight, you got one of the best champs to face at flyweight, and you're an incredible fighter. But, you know, she can't seem to make this 115.
Well, time to move on to a different weight class.
And for Marina Rodriguez, I almost feel bad that, you know, you took the fight from the lady because you thought, you know, oh, she can't make weight, she can't beat me. And then she, you know, and you end up with a draw, but she beat you in my eyes, you know. I don't know.
All right, man, the biggest, most shocking surprise of the evening. Heavyweight division, Alistair Overeem, 45-17, 1-0 contest, going up against the undefeated 9-0, Jairzinho Rozenstruik. And this fight was cool, man.
Yeah, it really was.
I enjoyed this fight.
Surprising in the sense, like, we didn't see that coming after the fight that we were watching, you know what I mean?
The fight was going in the other direction.
Before it started, you know, you thought Jairzinho was going to get the knockout. We called it first round. But Overeem,
because he's going up against Alistair Glassjaw Overeem.
But Overeem with a smart game plan, you know.
Almost perfect game plan.
The high guard was great. The only thing, like, when you get into the numbers, you could see that, you know, Rozenstruik landed quite a bit to the body.
Yeah.
You know, because his strike numbers are pretty high, higher than you would think.
Really?
Yeah, higher than Overeem's.
Really?
Yeah.
See, I would not have expected that. I thought that Overeem landed more.
Right, and more significant ones, too.
Can we get those numbers?
Yeah, Rozenstruik actually threw 229 strikes total.
Wow.
Lands 109.
Really?
And 89 significant.
Wow.
A lot of those were to the body, though.
Okay, you know? yeah, that makes sense.
And Alistair Overeem with 135 total strikes, compared to 229 Rozenstruik.
So almost over 100.
Right. Lands Overeem, though, lands 101, you know, so lands almost as much as Rozenstruik.
Correct.
Just didn't throw as much. 74 significant.
So pretty tight,
right,
in lands and significance.
Better percentage for Overeem.
Well, because Overeem is the most accurate striker in the UFC.
Very accurate. You know, he used those knees. He should have used them more, those clinch knees.
I personally think we might have saw the best Alistair Overeem we might have ever seen.
He was good. He had a great game plan. I just think he got a little too tired towards the end and gave up one big shot. You know, people are crying about the stoppage, but
how?
I don't think there's anything wrong with it. 4 seconds left in the entire fight at minute 4:56 seconds in round 5. You know, 4 seconds left in the fight. Gets the KO.
Talk about, like, a buzzer beater.
You know, just, I think that Overeem's silly takedown attempts throughout the fight were, you know, shooting from left field, like, were kind of, you know, stupid by
him. I was impressed with his
ground and pound.
Standing, twisting, slamming takedowns.
Right. I was, once he got a hold of Rozenstruik, but I don't know how much that shows, like, that Overeem is a good grappler or that Rozenstruik is not a good grappler.
Rozenstruik's not a good grappler. Right. He's a terrible grappler.
Right.
You put Alistair Overeem against a Francis Ngannou, and he's not taking him down like that.
Right. Great, tremendous right hand from Rozenstruik.
Blew his lip open, man.
And it was like he knew, I gotta land something now, right before the end. I don't want a decision.
He heard the clack and said, bang!
Or he thought, he thought that he was down on the cards because Overeem...
He had to have been down.
Overeem got... 2 takedowns out of 10, but still 2 takedowns.
But 2 takedowns to Rozenstruik's 0.
Right. So, and all the missed strikes by Rozenstruik, that could come into play. Mm-hmm. So he thought he was down for sure.
And I felt like Alistair Overeem forced his position to own the octagon.
Oh, right. And the aggression in the octagon control by Overeem for sure. He controlled the fight overall.
Yeah. It was Alistair's fight until 4 minutes, 90 seconds into the fifth round. And here's my thing. I will say this. When I first saw the punch, I love this because, Rozenstruik, in his mind, and he was correct, hit a walk-off homer. Because he cracked him, he hit the ground, and he immediately turns around and hands up. Now, you could say, oh, that was an early stoppage. What did you want Rozenstruik to do? Not put his hands down? And then, because Alistair's hands are down.
Right.
He was like this. And when the ref came over, that's when he got up. Yeah. If Rozenstruik stepped forward, it would have been uppercut, stop.
Now, see, what I wouldn't mind to see from Rozenstruik is him rush in. Maybe not swing again.
Yeah.
But close the distance on him. Don't walk away. You know what I mean? Because you don't know that Mergliata's coming in to stop him. You don't know that he's coming in to stop it. So, I mean, I think that comes from his kickboxing background. You knock a dude down, you go to the neutral corner until he gets counted out. You know? And I think, people are, saying it's questionable that he should have let it continue. I don't think so. Overeem got up pretty quickly,
but hit the fence.
Fell to the side. I mean, he didn't get up to engage and fight anymore. And we're talking about a guy whose record is incredibly long. The instinct alone will carry him back to his feet.
Correct.
All
right.
TKO for Rozenstruik.
Before jumping into news, because I think we got about just over 10 minutes left, let's hit, if we have any time after the news, after the preview.
Yeah, I did want to spend some time on this.
All right. So, UFC 245, Usman versus Covington, Saturday, December 14th, 10 p.m., T-Mobile Arena, Las Vegas. We're going to jump immediately into it. The prelims, middleweight division, Punhele Soriano, 6-0, going up against the 11-2-1, Oscar Piacota. Who do you got?
I don't really know anything about Punhele Soriano, except that name sounds kind of cool.
Yeah.
He's from the Contender Series. He's got takedowns. This is his debut. Piacota coming off 2 submission losses to one to Gerald Meerschaert and another Rodolfo Vieira. I'm going to go with the kid making his debut.
Soriano. Women's flyweight division. Jessica Ai, 14-7-1, no contest, going up against the 8-1 Vivian Arroyo.
It's a great fight.
Great fight.
This is like from our BMF card, pretty much. Arroyo, 2-0 in the UFC, which makes her, ranked number 3 or 4
in
the flyweight division. I think she's the better wrestler overall and has the better power overall here. Jessica Ai, 3-1 in the flyweight division, the one being, the devastating head kick loss to Shevchenko.
There it is.
Had a bad go in bantamweight before coming to flyweight, but Jessica Ai she's a gangster, man. She's going to scramble. She's going to show perseverance. And
she's going to stay in her
face. She's going to throw strikes, be aggressive, stay in her face. And on paper, it looks like a royal, but
Who you got?
I think I'm going with Jessica Eye.
All right, we're going to split it up. I'm going with Vivian.
I think she's going to surprise us.
In the flyweight division, directly off of the BMF.
Directly
off the BMF match that we set up, a fight that I've been looking forward to seeing. Brandon Moreno, 15-5-1, going up against 27-1, Kai Kara France. I can't wait for this fight. It's going to be exciting.
Yeah, I love all of Kai Kara France's fights. 3-0 in the UFC. Mm-hmm. He's the better striker in this matchup for sure. Brandon Moreno, he got a draw last time versus Askar Askarov.
Yep.
In September. I remember that because Askarov's name. Askar Askarov.
Exactly. Such a weird name.
But 10 submissions and 2 KOs. This is his second term with the UFC since being cut and brought back.
Okay.
I don't know. You got the surging up and comer or the vet. Who's
but they're
always,
both from the same, the,
who's
from the same Ultimate Fighter.
Right. Like I said, second term for Moreno.
I got to go with Kai.
I think so, too. Brandon Moreno kind of had his day, and this is Kai Kara France's prime.
All right. Featherweight division, main event of the early prelims, Chase Hooper, 6-0-1, going up against the 7-3, Daniel Tamer.
Daniel Tamer, younger brother of David Tamer, who's a longtime UFC vet. Heavy, heavy hands on the Tamers in general, mm-hmm. Daniel especially. He's displayed some bad cardio, had some bad grappling losses in the past. His last fight, can't remember who it was, but he showed better cardio, Josh something.
I remember he won that fight.
Not Emmett, but Josh something. Yeah, and he got a good decision win, showed better cardio, and snuck out of some submission attempts, so looked to have been closing up some holes in his mm-hmm. game. Chase Hooper.
18 years old.
Skinny, long. He's like, when you see the high school kids that didn't grow into their body yet?
Uh-huh, yeah.
They didn't
fill in.
You seen that one kid that plays hockey with us, the lefty?
Yeah, him. Exactly.
The one kid I was calling Gumby. Yeah. and he didn't know who that was. But anyways.
Wow.
That's what he looks like. Super long, super gangly. If it's a striking matchup, Chase Hooper's in a lot of trouble.
World of hurt.
His striking is just terrible. Mm-hmm. Like he's just... the lowest level of striking that you could make it to the
UFC. Incredible ground game, though.
The fact that you could make it to the UFC, yeah, that shows you how good his jiu-jitsu is.
Yep.
But his takedowns are crap. He can't get you to the mat. Unless Tamer falls on him.
Or takes him down himself.
Then he'll probably get himself a first-round KO. Daniel Tamer.
Daniel Tamer, indeed. Starting off into the prelims, Matt Brown, 21-16, going up against the 22-12-2, Ben Saunders.
Ben Saunders, 3 stop losses in a row.
Wow.
Matt Brown, KO versus Diego Sanchez last time with the big elbow that you see on every
elbow.
Highlight. Before that, KO loss to Jake Ellenberger.
Where he got knocked out.
I wrote that down because Ben Saunders has a TKO over Jake Ellenberger before the 3 stops that he suffered.
Mm.
Does that change anything against Matt Brown?
I go with Matt Brown.
Probably not. Matt Brown, Muay Thai specialist, always liked him.
Middleweight, Ian Heinich, 13-2, going up against the 19-4-1, Omari Akhmedov.
Yeah, Ian Heinich lost last time, decision win to Derek Brunson. He's an all-around fighter. 2-1 in the UFC, decent wrestler, decent puncher. Omari Akhmedov, 7-1 in the UFC.
Wow.
Wins versus Tim Bosch and Zach Cummings in his last 2. Another all-around fighter. This is a pick'em.
I like Ian Heinich.
I'm gonna go with him. I think as well. To see him rebound. Yeah.
Got to do it. Women's bantamweight division, another girl we've been talking about in the BMF matchup, the undefeated Ketlin Vieira going up against 11-5, Irene Aldana, another fighter we spoke on in the BMF fight.
Absolutely. Aldana with that great win against Vanessa Mello mm-hmm. last fight. Before that, lost to Raquel Pennington. Before that, had 2 good wins. great long range striking that we've seen from her, especially in the last fight.
Yeah.
Caitlin Vieira wins against Ashley Evans-Smith and Sarah McMahon and Kat Zingano. Good submissions, decent striking. Gotta go with Caitlin Vieira.
Absolutely, yeah. I'm with you.
That's gonna be exciting though if Adonna can get them hands going like she did last time.
I think this could be a fight of the night. So we'll see what happens.
Absolutely.
In the main event of the prelims in the welterweight division, Jeff Neal, 12-2, going up against the 13-5 Mike Perry. This is gonna be a slugger.
Fireworks. You know, Jeff Neal. Explosion. You know, he's from the contender. 4-0 in the UFC with three stoppages. Frank Camacho, Bilal Muhammad, and Nico Price.
Mm-hmm.
Explosive power. Just crazy.
Yeah, I like him a lot.
Mike Platinum Perry is 1-1 in his last two. He's 5-6 in the UFC overall.
Wow. Ugh.
But it's because he's a dog.
Yeah.
And he's just fun to watch.
Yeah, exactly. He's just
one of
those
guys
fighters
that can get losses and it doesn't hurt their stock. Like
exactly.
We say, you know, he's always going to be tough. He's always going to be hard to fight in every single position, and it's hard to put him away.
All right, in the main event. Starting it off with a big bang.
Who do we think, Jeff Neal or Mike Perry?
Oh, I put Jeff Neal.
Yeah, I got to go with that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right, starting it off with a bang. In the bantamweight division, Pelter Yan, 13-1, going up against the California kid, 35-10, Uriah Faber.
35-10, I like that record.
I love
honestly.
It.
Honestly. Uriah Faber, 8-7 overall in the UFC.
Wow.
You know, besides one fight, the only fights he's lost is title fights.
Yeah, championship fights. Yeah.
The poor man has just had every attempt and can't secure a belt.
And it felt like his last fight that he had lost before he decided to come back. I don't know. Who was it against? Was it Pelter Yan?
No.
I forgot who it was, but I remember he didn't have it. I feel like
no,
he just didn't
it was
have
a,
it.
It was a decision.
Decision loss.
Oh, God. Okay, I can't think of it.
Well, let's not waste any time on
Anyways, yeah. Great KO against Ricky Simone last time. Anyways, great wrestler, Uriah Faber. Great, great scrambles. I mean, he's always one of the better scramblers.
Yeah.
Wealth of experience, you know, former champion WEC.
An endless Swat gas everybody. Tank.
Yeah, endless conditioning. Pelter Yan, 4-0 in the UFC. Jimmy Rivera, John Dodson, Douglas Silva de Andrade, all been put to sleep by this man.
Mm-hmm.
Takedown defense is great. Unorthodox heavy strikes. I don't know how else to describe.
Yeah, unorthodox heavy strikes.
Unorthodox,
I like it.
Unorthodox heavy strikes. And I think he catches Faber.
Yeah, I don't know if he knocks him out, but I know he beats him.
Yeah.
Now we go to the bantamweight division. The awesome fight set up. Marlon Moraes, 22-6-1, going up against Jose Aldo, making his debut in the bantamweight division, 28-5.
Yeah. Jose been up and down. You know, his last fight was a loss to Volkanovski at featherweight. Before that, he had wins versus Stevens and Renato Marcano. Muay Thai, we know what he can do.
Yeah.
Marlon Moraes, TKO loss to Henry Cejudo last. He's a finishing specialist.
Yep. I feel like their styles are perfect.
Heavy Muay Thai. Yeah, like I think that Marlon Moraes makes me remember Jose Aldo from WEC.
Exactly.
You know,
exactly.
That's what he fights like. But strikes even harder, I think.
Oof.
Like Moraes is crazy, except he cuts crazy amount of weight. One thing I read that I thought was weird: California State Athletic Commission will not license him for a bantamweight fight without documentation from doctors because he gained 20 pounds last time from weigh into cage.
Wow,
that's crazy.
That is crazy.
But I think this is a beatdown for
Jose Aldo.
Jose Aldo.
Really? A beatdown?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think Marlon Moraes is going to show him something.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right. Now we get into the championship fights. I'm so mad we don't have more time to talk about these.
Yes.
In the women's bantamweight division, Amanda Nunes, 18-4, going up against the 9-3, Jermaine D. Ramadami.
Yeah. The biggest thing that I wish we had more time to talk about is the order of these these fights.
Yes.
Kamaru Usman does not deserve this main event.
Nope.
Yes, beating Tyrone Woodley is a great feat. Yes, you're the welterweight champion. You're not a popular champion. You've never defended. Everybody hates Colby Covington. It's only about the drama.
It's the drama that Colby Covington has created
right.
that got this fight on
top. I mean, Amanda Nunes should be in this main event.
Yeah. But if not, Max Holloway.
Right. But I don't think Max should main event over Amanda Nunes either. No offense to Max.
I mean, Max Holloway is just as dominant in his division.
No.
Yeah, I agree with you. We both know.
She's the biggest underselled fighter. I'm sorry I don't have more time to talk you up, Amanda. You are the best. There is. She already holds a KO versus Jermaine in her second fight in the UFC. Jermaine with the great length. Her boxing is real dangerous.
But Amanda Nunes got the pressure.
And we've seen it all before, you know. Amanda Nunes. For sure.
In the featherweight division, Max Holloway defending his title 21-4 against the 20-1 Alexander Volkanovski. And this is a fight we've been waiting for a long time.
Absolutely. Great, classy win last fight against Frankie Edgar by Max Holloway. You might hate me for saying this, but I'm going with Volkanovski.
What?
7-0 in the UFC. KOs Mendez. Decision versus Aldo last. Is good everywhere, but with crazy explosive
power.
But
a decision against Aldo, Max Holloway put him away twice.
Yeah. I agree.
All right. Yeah, I got to go, Max. That's my boy.
I got no hate for Max. I love him. I just think this kid is something else, I think. And I think he has the ability to do it. Do I think he's a better fighter than Max? No. Do I think he will beat him on this night? Yeah.
All right. And then the main event, welterweight division, Kamaru Usman, 15-1. And I thought this was interesting going up against the 15-1, Colby Covington, to unite it's already undisputed for Kamaru Usman, so
yes.
Forget Colby's belt.
Yeah, Colby's belt is long gone,
insignificant.
Yeah. When Tyron Woodley fought Darren Till for the belt, that made the interim title no longer valid.
Yes.
Yeah, and he still carries it around. Kamaru Usman, the Ultimate Fighter 21 winner, has blown through the division, beating guys like Leon Edwards, Wally Alves, Sergio Moraes, Rafael Dos Anjos, and then, of course, Tyron Woodley. Of course, we see no Wonder Boy on there, no Darren Till,
nope.
No Jorge Masvidal.
Nope.
So you wonder about the legitimacy of these guys.
Although Leon Edwards, that's a big victory.
That was his debut after the Ultimate Fighter finale.
Ooh, okay.
So that was like 2015.
Okay.
Colby Covington hasn't lost since 2015. Submission loss to Wally Alves, who was beaten by Kamaru Usman. He's 11-1 in the UFC. He's beaten Rafael Dos Anjos, big name, Damian Maia, Robbie Lawler, some of the big names that Colby Covington has put away.
Okay.
Again, no Wonder Boy, no Jorge Masvidal.
No.
I mean, and Covington never had to get through the likes of Woodley either. Wrestling, both of them. Cardio, both of them. Conditioning, both of them.
Yeah.
You know, we see decisions from these guys. That's what they do. Covington with some good toughness. I think Usman, what I like from bottom, and he never stops putting hurt on you.
Yeah.
Even in the clinch, he's pounding your body. The way that he worked Woodley's body
exactly.
while he was just holding on him, I think that's going to be the difference.
All right. I'm with you. Kamaru Usman all the way. And I think that does
it. I think
it
he
time.
Will win. But like I said, I want to see Covington win it.
Yeah,
so Masvidal.
Hell yeah. All right. That's all the time we have for you this week. We'll throw in the news that we have this week on next week's show.
It will still be relevant.
It will
Check
still
out
be
Taylor
relevant.
The Tape on Facebook, and maybe I'll throw some of it up later.
All right, no doubt. So until next week, we'll see you in the octagon. Have a good night.
Peace.